Good morning. Good morning. Happy Sunday to you all. Hope you had a great week this week. This morning, as we come before the Lord, we just want to acknowledge his great love. I think we say it, but we need to remember it. We need to remember it. Last week, Pastor Tim brought a sermon. He encouraged us, implored us to remember. And sometimes it's easy to forget the things that we know on the mountaintop. Sometimes as we go down into the valley and live the normal, humdrum normalcy of life, we tend to forget, at least I do, I tend to forget things, and I need to be reminded. And this morning, we want to remind ourselves of the love of God for us, the great love with which he loved us. Even while we were still his enemies, he gave himself sacrificially, and we never want to lose sight of that. So this morning, we want to rejoice in his love, and for that reason, I like the words of this song, how it starts. It starts out with an exclamation. It starts out, yeah! Because that's the freedom that we live in. Because of the love of God, we are a free people in Christ. And so we celebrate that this morning. So let's do that together as we stand and sing, Because of Your Love.
Yeah. As you come.
singing, great singing. Stay standing as we sing. Come behold the wondrous mystery. Lifestyle is that we see God for who he is. We see the person of Jesus Christ as we've just sung in this song. And as a response to that, that's what we call worship, that response of seeing and savoring the person of Jesus Christ. That's called worship. And so that's what we want to do this morning. And one of those, the Bible talks about different ways that people responded to how they saw God and how they met with God. And one of those ways was that they would bow. They would bow to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And so this morning, at the mercy of God, at the cost that it took to sacrifice his son, at the cost that it took for Jesus Christ to give of his great love for us, we want to in turn worship him by saying, "Here I bow. Here I bow." Let's sing together. If you don't know the song, that's fine. You feel free to just listen to the words and let it wash over your spirit.
Where would I run but to the throne of mercy? Where would I kneel but at this cross of grace? How great the love,
if we can. Let's go back up to that chorus to the top. Here we go.
So here I bow to lift you high. Jesus, be glorified in all things. For all my life I am yours.
Yours.
I am yours forever.
All right, good morning, everyone. Oh, well, actually, the sanctuary is a lot more full than I thought. Just out of curiosity, do we have any junior hires in here today? Where are the junior hires? Lift your hands. I know we got a couple up here. Oh, okay. There's more than I thought because, in case you didn't know, they just returned from CBM camp yesterday, and I heard it was a kind of a long bus ride, but they all arrived safe and sound. I had the joy of being up there for about half the week. My family and I, we went up. I was able to teach a workshop, and man, it was a wonderful time at camp. And I'm sure the parents, depending on your kid, maybe they told you a lot or a little about what happened. But it was a joyous time. The gospel was preached, and I'm happy to report that even one of our own junior hires professed faith in Christ. And this is an amazing thing, and we can actually, you know, let's give a hand for that, you know. Yeah. And of course, high schoolers. I had a chance to chat with a few of our high schoolers. Not to put you on the spot, but how many of you have already packed for camp? Oh no. Not one hand. Okay. Well. Hopefully between now and tomorrow morning, you'll get your packing done because high school camp heads up tomorrow. And I won't be able to make it up this week, but this coming week, but Deacon Gary, will be going up to teach a workshop as well this week. So we can't wait to hear back from him. So today, as we come before the Lord in prayer, we want to give thanks for a wonderful week of junior high CBM camp. And we want to lift up all of the high schoolers, all of the counselors, the directors, and workshop teachers that will be going up this week. And we'll ask the Lord's blessing as we come before him and get into his word. So let's pray. Oh, and sorry, forgot. You know, I came back from camp. Children, thank you for sitting with us. You're dismissed. And with that, let's pray. Father God, Lord, it's amazing what a short week away can do. Lord, that's a testament to how easily we are distracted, but that is also a testament of how gracious and good you are. Lord, that as soon as we set some time aside and we come before you and we are immersed in your word, we are surrounded by your people, we are able to lift up our praises to you, we see you so much more clearly. Lord, and I know this is true for the junior hires who attended camp this week. Lord, from the sharing at campfire to some of the testimonies I heard, to even what some of the counselors shared with me, Lord, I know you are working in the lives of our junior hires. Lord, I thank you especially for this one particular junior hire who came to salvation. And Lord, it's a shame that we don't hear it too often, but it's also a testament that there are so many believing kids who go up to camp, but we thank you for this individual. We thank you that they have placed their faith in Christ as their Savior, and we are just excited for them to start living their new life in Christ. Lord, thank you for overseeing all of camp this past week. Lord, despite some injuries, Lord, despite some homesickness, Lord, you allow this camp to go well. You brought the kids up there safely. You brought them back. We thank you for all the counselors, the directors, the teachers that have put in so much work and effort to minister to these students. And Lord, as we give thanks, we also continue to ask for your guidance, for your provision for this coming week. Lord, we pray that, well, first of all, you will help our high school students to get all their packing done, to be prepared mentally, physically, spiritually for camp. We know it'll be a great time of fellowship and fun, but Lord, would you prepare their hearts, prepare their minds for the messages that they will be hearing? Lord, for the songs of praise that they'll be lifting up to you, for the prayer requests that they will share and they will hear, for the workshops that they will attend, for the conversations, the life walks with their counselors. Lord, that amidst all of the fun and hanging out, Lord, that they are able to hear you more clearly, that they are able to draw closer to you. They are able to perhaps renew their dedication, perhaps be strengthened, especially for our seniors as they go off to college very soon. Lord, we pray for all of the counselors who will be going up and the directors, and specifically we want to lift up Gary as he will be teaching a workshop next week. Lord, we pray that in addition to just his preparation for his workshop, Lord, that you will give him many opportunities, many unplanned, unscheduled opportunities to have conversations, to go deeper with our kids, to just even get to know some of our students better. And Lord, we pray that throughout this camp, Lord, of course, we pray for safety, we pray for the health of all involved, but Lord, we pray that in spite of and on top of everything that happens, Lord, that you will be glorified, that even if there are difficulties and tough times, that the students can see the staff respond in a way that will bring glory to you. Lord, that even if there are injuries or people who are overwhelmed, Lord, that they will see such a response as to give glory to you. So, Lord, we want to lift up next week of camp. We entrust it into your hands. And right now, as we come before your word, may you also open our hearts and minds. Lord, help us to understand, to comprehend, and to intake what you have to say to us. But most of all, by your Holy Spirit, would you change us and transform us by your word more into the image of Christ? And it is in his name we pray. Amen. Now, if you have your Bibles, I encourage you to turn to the book of 1 Corinthians. We are continuing our study in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 today. And as always, if you don't have your sermon note packet, please raise your hand, and we'll make sure our ushers get one to you. And it seems like most of you have it, so that's great. But today we're continuing on in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 as part of an ongoing conversation, if you want to call it in nice terms, a conversation, perhaps a lecture, perhaps a scolding that the Apostle Paul is giving to the Corinthians. And as we continue on, I actually want to start, and to kind of help us understand what we're going to be talking about today, I want to start by actually sharing a story, sharing about a very interesting individual. This gentleman here, he is a doctor. His name is Walter Jackson Freeman II. He was a very highly regarded physician from the 1920s, 1930s. He was trained in University of Pennsylvania, and he also continued to study neurology in Europe. And he was actually appointed the chair of the neurology department at George Washington University. And that's where he also received a PhD on top of his medical degree. Now, I'm sharing all of this with you, and he sounds accomplished, but that's not what Dr. Freeman was known for. You see, unfortunately, despite all of his vast medical experience and knowledge, and despite the fact that he is actually considered someone who was a pioneer in the field of neurosurgery, he is best known for as one of the strongest advocates of the medical procedure called a lobotomy. In case you're not familiar, this is a treatment, a surgical procedure that was popular between the 1940s, 1950s, and it's seen as one of the best ways to treat, well, perhaps not the best way, but a common way to treat mental illness. So for schizophrenics, for people who suffer from psychosis, a lot of them underwent this procedure, which involves the physical severing of certain areas of your brain. And one of the ways they did it was actually, you know, a sharp implement that was put through, I believe, you know, one of the openings in your eye. If, believe it or not, it's kind of gruesome. But Dr. Freeman was one of not only was he one of the champions of this procedure, he was also one of the ones who performed the most lobotomies. According to my research, they said that about 20,000 lobotomies had been performed in the 1950s. And out of those 20,000, Dr. Freeman was responsible for 3,500 of them. Now, as so many lobotomies were being performed, people started to realize, like, hey, this is probably not the best way to treat mental illness, or even in some cases, according to statistics, homosexuality. Men who struggle with homosexuality were lobotomized in this time. And strangely enough, a large percentage of lobotomies were performed on women, up to 74% in some areas. And people started realizing there's some terrible side effects that came from this procedure. Even Dr. Freeman himself, as he explains it, and as he tries to justify it, he says, well, what we're really doing is trying to induce a surgically induced childhood in the patient. The way he saw it, by performing this procedure, he was resetting the person to a more childlike state where then they can kind of recover and develop more normally. And yet, even as he described it, he described a 29-year-old woman who underwent this procedure. And after this lobotomy, he said she had a smiling, lazy, and satisfactory demeanor with the personality of an oyster. Can you believe it? This is the proponent. This is, hey, this is a good procedure. This is the result. She had the personality of an oyster. Now, what he meant was that she was kind of at this neutral state from which she can recover, but many, many people did not. In fact, out of the 3,500 lobotomies he performed, there were 490 patients who subsequently died as a direct result or a secondary result of the procedure. See, unfortunately, even with all of his pedigree and training, he will forever be linked with this very, very gruesome and now very outdated and very, you know, frowned upon procedure. It was a tragedy of misguided knowledge. A misguided understanding of medicine and science can have very horrific effects on your brain, on your personality, on your body. But a misguided understanding of theology and scripture can have even worse effects because it affects your soul. It affects your eternity. And that's the focus of today's passage. As we get into this passage, I will give you a warning. We're going to have to do some, you know, you're going to have to track with me today. This is a not complicated, but Paul's argument can be easily misinterpreted, can be easily misunderstood. So track with me, and we're going to really dive into the heart of what Paul has to say today. So I invite you, would you stand with me, and let's read along together today's passage, which is from 1 Corinthians 6, chapters 12 through 14. You can read in your Bibles or follow along on the screen. This is from the ESV translation. But here we go. All things are lawful for me, but not all things are helpful. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be dominated by anything. Food is meant for the stomach, and the stomach for food, and God will destroy both one and the other. The body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And God raised the Lord and will also raise us up by his power. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. You may please be seated. So as you can see, this passage, we're kind of getting into the middle of a conversation Paul is already having, so we're going to have to do a little bit of setup and to help us understand exactly what he's talking about. But in terms of a big picture, what I want us to glean from today's study in this passage is this. I believe Paul is teaching the Corinthians as well as us that there are three deadly abuses of Christian liberty, but he also gives us three remedies for them. He's talking about three ways that the Corinthian church have misunderstood this concept of Christian liberty, but he's also giving us three remedies. So that being said, let's understand exactly what's happening here. If you've been following along, sometimes if you're reading through 1 Corinthians, you may be kind of scratching your head, and some of you may be looking at, you know, chapter 5 and chapter 6, and you may be like, Paul, come on, man. You're supposed to be this great orator. You're all over the place, right? In chapter 5, Paul starts by talking about, he's addressing this a case of gross sexual immorality in the church, a man sleeping with his stepmother. And then he talks about that, right, how that's wrong. He goes from that into talking about, well, you know, we need to be careful who we relate to in the church. And then in chapter 6, he goes from talking about sexual immorality, he then starts talking about this random court case where two brothers in the church, two members of the church, one is suing the other one. And then he's kind of bringing it back to talking about sexual morality again, and then he goes into this thing, right? He's talking about, well, you know, all things are lawful, all things are, and the food is meant for the stomach and the stomach for food. And you're reading this, you're like, Paul, what's the point? Where are you? You're kind of all over the place, right? Are you talking about sexual morality? Are you talking about brothers suing brothers? What are you talking about? Well, this passage actually helps us kind of understand the underlying process, that a problem that ties all of these issues together, right? When we look at the Corinthian church, and a lot of times we look at our church, you may think like, well, we're struggling in all these areas, right? The Corinthian church has issues with sexual morality. They have issues with legalism. They have issues with division, you know, picking teachers over another. But in this passage, we see part of the underlying issue with the Corinthian church. The problem is a lot of them misunderstand. They have a misguided understanding of Christian liberty. They really struggle with this concept of Christian liberty. And in a nutshell, and we'll actually develop more, but Christian liberty is this understanding that because Christ has saved us from the penalty and power of sin in our lives, Christians are free to live in a much less restricted manner than other religions. In other words, they don't have to work for their salvation. They don't have to do good deeds to earn the grace of God. But specifically, when we talk about Christian liberty, a lot of times we talk about, well, can Christians participate in certain activities that we may consider gray areas? Not outright sins, but perhaps socially questionable or non-spiritual, right? In modern day Christianity, a lot of times these areas include things like movies. Can Christians go to a movie theater to watch movies, partake of certain entertainments? Issues of alcohol use. Can Christians drink alcohol? Can they not? Even more recently, there's a debate, you know, should Christians send their kids to public schools, or should Christians all homeschool their kids? You know, there's good arguments for, you know, abstaining from these things and going a certain way, but you wouldn't say, like, this is absolutely what the Bible 100% says you must do. They're not outright sins. They're kind of gray areas. Right? And we see this in Scripture as well. In Paul's time, some of these gray areas or controversial areas, including can Christians eat food sacrificed to idols? Right, a lot of new believers back then were saved out of idolatry. Right, they were worshiping some of these gods before, and now they became Christians, and a lot of times had trouble with, well, Christians, we shouldn't be eating the food that was sacrificed to those idols. That was meant for that pagan worship. That was supporting those false gods set up against the true God. We shouldn't do that. While more mature Christians were saying, well, those false gods aren't anything. They're made from wood. They don't have any power over the real God. I should be free to eat that food. And we see many passages that address this. But to kind of summarize what the Corinthian church was doing, the Corinthian church, they were basically, in this issue of Christian liberty, they were committing the two mistakes when it comes to Christian liberty. If you can imagine Christian liberty as walking a tightrope, right? On the one side, you can fall into the area of legalism, of saying, no, you must follow these certain rules to be a good Christian. You must abstain from this and that. And in fact, legalism can go so far as to be outright heretical, as to basically preach a different gospel, where some individuals are saying, in order to be a Christian, you also must be circumcised. You must keep part of the old Mosaic law that was meant for Jewish people. That's one side of the tightrope that you can fall into, legalism. On the other side of the tightrope, you know, in this balance of Christian liberty, you can fall into what's called licentiousness. This is a big way of saying it's a license to sin. You use Christian liberty as a license to sin. You say, well, if the Bible doesn't say I can't do it, I'm free to do it, right? It's that idea. It's basically, you know, and parents, you get that, right? You come home and you see that your kid has drawn on the wall. And you're like, why did you do that? And they'll say, well, you didn't actually say I can't draw on the wall, right? You just said be good, right? You know, you didn't tell me not to draw on the wall, so you can't get angry at me, right? It's that idea, right? If God didn't tell me I can't do it, it must be okay. Right? And the Corinthians were, strangely enough, as we'll see as we continue the study, they were falling on both sides. Some of them were very super legalistic, right? Can't do this. You know, you're not a good Christian if you do this and that. Some of them were super licentious, like anything goes. And that's what Paul is trying to address today. And I hope that can help us understand a little bit what he's getting into. Now, more specifically, the structure of today's passage, if it seems a little strange to you, you know, you see those quotations. I'll pop it back just real quick for us to see. You see those quotation marks. Basically, to help us understand what Paul is doing is he's taking some of the common phrases that the Corinthian church is like to say to justify what they're doing. Like, for example, one of their phrases is, all things are lawful for me. So that's why you see it in quotes. But Paul is giving commentary and a rebuttal to that common phrase from the Corinthians. Right? So that's to help us understand it. So hopefully you're at least somewhat familiar with what we're going through. It'll make sense as we go through it. But let me just get right into it. So the first abuse that we see Paul addressing, that the Corinthians the way that the Corinthians are abusing Christian liberty is they were practicing Christian liberty without discernment. Right? They were exercising their Christian liberty without giving any thought at all. How do we see this? Well, this is the first part of verse 12. Right? Paul, right from the get-go, right? He's quoting them. Okay, you guys say all things are lawful for me, but I, Paul, here, I'm here to tell you, not all things are helpful. Right? You kind of see that? He's saying, you guys say this, this is what I say in response to that. That's the structure of this verse. And, you know, you may be wondering, well, why is this such a slogan, such a phrase that the Corinthian church like to say? All things are lawful for me. Well, they were using that idea of Christian liberty and just kind of reducing it to this one saying, all things are lawful for me. It's a very incomplete, a very immature understanding of Christian liberty. But they're basically saying, it's their way of saying, well, I can do anything. Right? In Christ, I can do anything. Which you may say, well, in some ways that's true, but not the way that they're thinking. In fact, there's actually a lot of scriptural basis for this phrase. In and of itself, this phrase is not wrong for a Christian to say. Like, a Christian can say, all things are lawful for me, but we have to understand that within the bounds of Scripture. See, I think what the Corinthians may have had in mind will be similar to some of what we can read in Colossians chapter 2. I don't have the verse up there for you, but if you have your Bibles, turn to Colossians chapter 2 if you're able. And you can get an idea where the Corinthians get this idea from. Okay, Colossians chapter 2. You can start at verse 16. And again, Paul here, now that we've understood, right, legalism, licentiousness, in Colossians, Paul is going after the legalists, right? He's going after people who say, you must be circumcised to be a Christian. So this is what Paul is writing to those legalists. And he's saying in Colossians 2:16, he says, therefore, let no one pass judgment on you in questions of food and drink, or with regard to a festival or a new moon or a Sabbath. If you jump down a little bit to verse 20, He says, if with Christ you died to the elemental spirits of the world, why, as if you were still alive in the world, do you submit to regulations? Verse 21, do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. See, Paul, as he's going after the legalists, he's talking about, well, we have all this freedom in Christ. So you shouldn't be saying these things. You shouldn't be saying, well, you can't eat this, you can't eat that, right? Don't touch this, don't touch that. As Christians, we have freedom in Christ. The problem is the Corinthians are only focusing on the verses that say, well, hey, let no one pass judgment on you. You know, don't say, do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. They miss the rest of that, and they're saying, hey, Scripture tells us, you can't pass judgment on me on what I'm doing, right? All things are lawful for me. That's their immature, kindergarten understanding of Christian liberty. Right, that's the problem. They were practicing liberty without discernment. They were not thinking about it. So, the first remedy. Right, what does Paul say to them? Well, he says, yeah, all things are lawful for me, but not all things are helpful. That's key there. You see, that tells us the problem that he's pointing to was that the Corinthians were confused. They were applying their Christian liberty and doing all sorts of things that were not helpful. They were doing this without a purpose in mind except to just indulge in liberty. Just, in the same way a kid might indulge in candy, right? If you just say, for example, today is Olivia's birthday, my daughter's birthday. She's turning 5 today, right? So I asked her, hey, honey, it's your birthday. We'll do a birthday dinner for you tonight. What do you want for dinner, right? And she said, cake, right? Now, of course, as a good parent, I said, no, I'll give you some choices, right? Do you want chashu? She chose chashu, by the way. Right, but in the same way, as a child might say, well, if you ask me what I want to eat for dinner, I'm going to choose whatever I want. I'm going to say cake. It's that same way. There's no discernment, right? The Corinthians are practicing freedom without discernment. And Paul is saying, no, you have to choose things that are beneficial or helpful. And what's beneficial and helpful is what is of service to God and to others. And if the Corinthians were indeed as wise as they say, they would be familiar with teachings of verses such as Galatians 5:13. Right? This puts Christian freedom into context. For you are called to freedom, brothers. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh to indulge yourself, but through love, serve one another. 1 Peter 2:16, similar idea. Live as people who are free. You are free, but not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. See, the remedy to a lack of discernment is to use your freedom to pursue service. Now, so even if you're a young Christian, and you may not have read the entire Bible, and you may not know exactly what God wants or not, the safe thing to do is to use your freedom to serve God and serve others. It's very hard to go wrong if that's what you do. Use your freedom to pursue service instead of abuse your freedom to indulge your desires without any discernment. I'm reminded, I don't know if anyone here, have you ever heard of something called First Amendment auditors? Has anyone heard of that before? Okay, good. Well, I don't know how I stumbled upon this. The idea of First Amendment auditors, that's what they call themselves. These are people who basically say, hey, we want to test if a police department or if a government building understands the First Amendment. So what we're going to do is we're going to do things like go up to a cop and start cussing them out, right? And if they arrest us, well, no, you've violated my First Amendment rights. So they call themselves First Amendment auditors, but they just seem like troublemakers in many ways. They'll go into government buildings, and start walking around and start filming. And when officials ask them to stop, which technically they're not supposed to do, so again, what they're doing is not technically wrong. They'll get in their face and go, you can't stop me, I have my First Amendment rights. See, I understand their intent. And in fact, some of what they may they're doing could be good, right? We should be able to see if our government officials understand our First Amendment rights. But I have a I have a problem with their mindset and their methods, right? You know, it's one thing to want to protect rights, but it's another to I want to do the very worst thing I can, you know, push the limit of what's allowable within the law, and just to, you know, try to, you know, goad you into reacting against me. That's their idea, right? And unfortunately, that's what the Corinthians, that's the attitude the Corinthians seem to have with Christian liberty, right? We want to get away with as much as possible. We want to push the limits, and that's the way we celebrate Christian liberty, by showing you just how much we can get away with. Right, that's their idea. They missed the point. Right, Christian liberty is meant to give us freedom to serve God and to love others, right? Not to indulge ourselves. That's their first mistake and the first remedy that Paul gives. This leads us to abuse number two. Abuse number two is they were practicing Christian liberty without discipline. Christian liberty without discipline. The second part of verse 12b, Paul quotes him again, "All things are lawful for me, but I will not be dominated by anything." And you see, again, Paul's focus now, he's pointing out where they're misunderstanding Christian liberty. Right? Because by his words, "I will not be dominated by anything," the implication is that the Corinthians were being dominated. They were actually in slavery, even though they considered themselves to be free. By their wrong application of Christian liberty, they were actually making themselves slaves to sin, slaves to popular opinion, slaves to each other. And again, looking at, looking at Paul's words, "I will not be dominated by anything," right? It shows that they were practicing their liberty without any discipline. Their liberty, practice of liberty, led to access, a lack of control, and dominance by sin. Even some of the problems that we see, they were so, you know, kind of loosey-goosey that even when there's a clear case of sexual immorality in their church, right, they didn't do anything about it. In fact, they say, "Look at how tolerant we are. Look at how gracious we are." They were almost celebrating the fact that they allowed this sinful brother to continue. They allow brothers to sue one another. Right, who are we to judge, even though those two brothers were obviously being enslaved by their anger and their conflict? See, that's the paradox of Christian liberty, is when we abuse Christian liberty, we actually get enslaved again. That's why Galatians chapter 5, verse 1 warns us, "For freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery." What this is saying isn't saying, like, you know, don't let anyone take your Christian liberty away. What it's really talking about, it's saying, don't abuse the freedom that Christ has given you, and instead make yourself a slave to legalism or a slave to licentiousness. Liberty without discipline. So the remedy that Paul gives is this: use your freedom to pursue self-control. Right? "I will not be dominated by anything." There's a play on words there. This idea of "all things are lawful" in the Greek, it comes from the same root as that word "dominated." It has to do with authority. Basically, the idea is all things I have authority to decide, you know, what to do. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be under the authority of anything, is what Paul says. Use your freedom to pursue self-control. See, for the Christian, oftentimes, our Christian liberty is best defined by what we freely choose to say no to so that we can pursue something better. That's the freedom Christ gave us. He gave us the freedom to say no to sins, to say no to distraction, so we can pursue better things. Paul himself, he applies the same principle to himself. 1 Corinthians 9:27. Right, we're going to get there in chapter 9. All right, the spoiler alert, the conversation about Christian liberty will continue on. He'll go into more detail in chapter 9. But Paul talks about himself. He says, I do the same thing for myself, right? He says, "I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. And he goes on to talk about the many things he says no to, even though he is free to, it's okay to, he says no so that he can be more effective for ministry, so that he won't disqualify himself, he won't fall into temptation. And there is a theological reason for this. Why is it that Christian liberty, you know, means that we say no to things still? Isn't that the opposite of what freedom is? You know, many times we think of freedom as our ability to do something, right? We should be free to do this or that. We should be free to live this way or that. But for Christians, our freedom is defined really in two ways. Let me show you in Romans chapter 6. Christian liberty is kind of thought of in two ways. First, we are free from the power, the penalty of sin in our lives, right? Romans 6, 12. Let not sin, therefore, reign in your mortal body to make you obey its passions. Before someone comes to Christ, they are a slave to sin. They cannot help but sin. Even in their best intentions, their sinful motives, all wrapped up in there, we cannot help. We are slaves to sin. But after Christ saves us, it's not just like, you know, hey, now you're free. I've paid for your sin. You can go and do whatever you want. No. Verse 14, for sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. Right? Sin will have no dominion over you because you're not under the penalty of the law now, but you are under the grace of God. And the grace of God itself implies there's certain ways of living, certain expectations. But it's not defined by rules, it's defined by a personal, living, growing relationship with God. Right, so no longer are you, well, you're a rule breaker, but you can live in such a way as to break fellowship with God. You can live in such a way as to get yourself further away from Christ. You can live in such a way, as Scripture tells us, you can quench the Holy Spirit. You can grieve the Holy Spirit. You can devastate your relationship with God by the free choices you make, even though, you know, technically speaking, you may not, you know, be in sin. Right? Even most of the time you are. Right? You see, that's the difference. Even though we're under grace, that doesn't mean there's no consequences or we have freedom to do whatever we want. No, we are under grace for the purpose of pursuing a closer relationship with God. And Christian liberty is meant to give us freedom to pursue holiness, not to pursue whatever we want. Christian liberty must be practiced with discipline. And finally, this leads us to our third abuse, which is liberty without devotion. See, at the heart of this problem, you know, you have no discernment, you have no discipline, but really what they lacked, they had a lack of devotion and understanding of the Lord. That was the heart of it. All right, Paul quotes them again. Food is meant for the stomach and the stomach for food, and God will destroy both one and the other. Before we go on, there is a bit of an interpretational issue here. I just want to briefly touch on. This is a difficult passage to understand exactly what it means because, unlike in a translation in the Greek, you can't really tell what's in quotes and what's not. So the question here is the entirety of verse 13 a quote that Paul is quoting from the Corinthians? Is the Corinthians saying, food is meant for the stomach and the stomach for food, and God will destroy both one and the other? That's the complete saying. Or is it just the first part? I personally lean towards actually considering all of verse 13 as, you know, the Corinthians' slogan. This is what the Corinthians were saying, all of verse 13. And there's a reason for that, which I will see. And apparently I set off my watch. I don't know why. But so just very quickly, the reason I believe this is the case, that all of verse 13 is Paul quoting the Corinthians, is because if you look at verse 14, which is absolutely Paul's own statement, it's a complete mirror of this statement. right? The body is meant for the Lord, is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body, and God raised the Lord and will raise us up by his power. So you see that there's a complete parallel. So Paul is refuting both parts of this verse, not just the first part. So even though in your translation like mine, it may just show quotes on the first part, personally, I believe the better interpretation is to put quotes on both, okay? If you can track with that, that's cool. If not, you know, it'll make sense, okay? But this will bear some unpacking. What, you know, what is going on here? Why is Paul saying this? Food is meant for the stomach and the stomach for food, and God will destroy both one and the other. What's wrong with this statement? Isn't that true? In a sense, it is, right? At face value, you may take this to mean, like, don't put too much emphasis on your earthly desires, on what you're going to eat, right? It seems to be that you can interpret this verse as saying, you know, don't chase food. Don't be all about food. No, don't, what is it? Eat to live. Don't live to eat, right? That's kind of what this verse is saying. Because at the end, God's going to destroy both, right? We're not going to have hunger and, you know, God's going to destroy the physical. Isn't that true? There's some truth to that, but that's not the way the Corinthians were actually using this verse. You see, the problem is the Corinthian church, they, you know, one of the things about them, they thought that they were very wise. And it's kind of apparent from statements like this, they allowed some worldly thinking to enter their church. Because what is being expressed here is this idea of dualism. Dualism is a thought that originated with the Greeks. And basically, it's this idea that anything physical is evil and bad. There's nothing good in anything physical. So our bodies, our bodily desires, bodily functions, anything physical on earth, bad, evil. It'll be destroyed. Anything spiritual, anything immaterial is good. So the mind, the spirits, our thoughts, that's good, and that will last forever. And the Corinthian church has kind of taken that and mixed it with Christian thought in a way that's to say, so here's the line of thinking. Okay, see if you follow. Well, you know, Paul says, and the Bible teaches that, you know, food offered to idols is nothing. We shouldn't argue and pass judgment on what Christians eat, right? Food is meant for the stomach and the stomach for food. It's not important. And if God's going to destroy it all because all of our physical being is evil, God's going to wipe it out anyway. So that's where they go wrong. That's dualism. That's not actually what the Bible teaches. But they think, well, if all this physical stuff is going away and it's okay for us to eat because hunger is a physical desire, shouldn't we be able to indulge some of our other physical desires since it's all going to go away anyway, right? It's this idea, okay, if you follow with me. I for some reason, I use kids a lot, right? Imagine your kid is out playing in the field, right? And they're running around and maybe they got their feet dirty. You're like, okay, come on in. We're going to give you a bath tonight, right? And they say, well, if I'm getting a bath, I might as well just roll around in the mud, right? Why just dirty my feet? I'm going to jump in the mud hole because I'm going to get washed anyway. That's their idea, right? If the physical, everything is going to be destroyed, I should be able to indulge as much as I want. And, you know, my spirit, my soul will still be pure, and that'll be okay. So that's what they're actually saying with this verse. It's not saying, you know, don't pay attention to your physical desires. It's saying indulge what you want because it's all going away. And spoiler alert, if you look at the rest of verse 6, there's a strong implication what they're trying to justify, believe it or not, if you look at the rest of chapter 6, is they're trying to say it's okay for Christians to visit prostitutes. Right? Because that's what the rest of chapter 6 actually focuses on. If you can believe that. They're using this argument that, well, you know, Christians shouldn't worry about what food they eat to say, well, in the same way, then, Christians should be able to indulge, sexually, even as far as going to visit prostitutes. So we've gone from, you know, maybe ignorance, slavery, now we've gone to outright perversion of the Word of God. Right? It kind of built on each other. They were perverting the Word of God to justify what is outright, blatantly sinful. This is not a liberty issue anymore. It becomes a very clear issue of sin. That's the problem with, not having a good understanding of Christian liberty. It is very often a slippery slope that can lead you into outright sin if we don't understand what it's meant for. So let's look at Paul's remedy for this abuse. You see, the heart of the problem of the Corinthians is they were practicing Christian liberty without Christ. They left Christ out of the picture. This is why Paul completely refutes their statement. He's like, you think that's how it is? You think God's going to destroy it? No, you forget. The body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And instead of God destroying it, God raised the Lord and will also raise us up by his power. See, we often look at a verse like verse 16, it's like, oh, that's so encouraging. It's a reminder that God will raise us up. But Paul actually meant it as a warning. He meant it as a warning to the Corinthians who think that anything bad I do with my physical body doesn't count. No, he's saying, no, God cares about all of you, body, mind, and soul. And he will raise up your body on the last day, just as he raised Christ up. You guys forgot that. How can you forget that? See, Christian freedom is centered on the person of Jesus Christ. Because Jesus is God and man, he has demonstrated for us what it means to be this combination of, you know, spirit and flesh. Right? And it's incredibly important that even after the resurrection, Jesus just didn't say, well, you know, I'm back. I'm going to be back to being a spirit again. Forget this body. No, Jesus took his physical body with him, his transformed, glorified physical body with him. What we do in this body matters. And it has eternal consequences. But the good news, and there is hope in this verse, the good news is that there are eternal consequences, but that also means whatever we do in this body can have eternal value as well. And because God cares about all of you. Which is why Romans chapter 6, verse 4, you know, beautifully describes this union. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of God, glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. The beauty of the Christian life is we can start living that new life we have in Christ, that eternal life we have in Christ now. Right? We often think of Christianity, oh, well, I said a prayer, I came to Christ, now my eternity is secure. I have eternal life with God in heaven. But we forget we're supposed to be starting to live that eternal life now. Right? And not all of it. We don't have fully all the aspects of it. We still struggle with sin, and we will until we die or see the Lord face to face. But we can live that eternal life now. That's the freedom Christ gives us. We can walk in newness of life. And finally, jumping back down to a later verse in Romans 6, but thanks be to God that you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient from the heart to the standard of teaching to which you were committed. And having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. See, that's the paradox. It's not just that we are free to be our own masters. We traded the old evil master who's dooming us to hell, sin. We traded for the righteous, gracious master who will lead us to eternal life, Christ. Use your freedom to live for the Lord. In closing, I just want to share with you a story. I might have shared this before, but it is a story I come back to because it is such a perfect illustration. When I first started serving youth ministry, this is probably about 10 or 12 years ago in SoCal, a young man named Brian, he was 17 years old, he attended our group. He was this big guy, very friendly, soft-spoken. Brian had to be hospitalized. I remember it was in the middle of the week because he had an infection. But it was a very strange combination. I still don't know exactly what happened, but that infection affected his heart. So even though he went into the hospital with kind of like flu-like symptoms, he actually needed a heart transplant by Friday. It was that quick. Right? His heart was, because of the way the infection was working, it was dying. Right? And we were shocked. The parents were, as you can imagine, just kind of out of their minds. And we were praying. We were praying for Brian, and you know, we were just praying for God for a miracle. We were thinking, right? Heart transplant list. It takes years for people. Maybe, you know, pray that he can get one soon. Amazingly enough, a miracle did happen. It really was that quick. He went into the hospital on Wednesday, needed a new heart on Friday. He got a new heart on Monday. It was that amazing. I never heard of it before. All the nurses, doctors, like, we've really never seen this. Somehow he was able to be bumped up to the list, maybe because of his age. He got a new heart. And you know, praise the Lord, I still see updates about him on Facebook. He's probably in his late 20s now. He's still alive. He still has to go in. He had a new heart. But can you imagine, right? He has a new life. You know, he was given a new chance. Can you imagine what people would think? Right, you know, what we would think if you look on his Facebook, look at his profile maybe 10 years later, and you find out he's a pack-a-day smoker, right? His favorite food is bacon, and he doesn't exercise. But you would say, what a waste. What are you doing with this new heart? And at the heart of this passage, this is what Paul is talking about. And for some of you, you know, maybe you've never experienced true freedom in Christ, and maybe what you need is that new heart, is to be free from your sin, and you can come to Christ today. But for some of you, maybe you are living a life that you are wasting your new heart, you are wasting and abusing your freedom in Christ, and you need to turn and repent, because there's so much more that Christ has freed us to do. Let's pray. Father God, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the freedom that we have in Christ, our freedom which cost him everything. Lord, we thank you for our new life which required his as a sacrifice. We thank you for our new family, the family of God, which required that he be rejected. Lord, as we consider all that we have in Christ, may we use our freedom, may we use your grace to serve you, to serve others, to pursue holiness, and not to indulge in our own desires, Lord. We pray these things and we lift these things up in your Son's name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Tim. One of the verses that passages that Pastor Tim referenced was in Romans chapter 6, starting at verse 12. It says, therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in its lusts, and do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under law, but under grace. So as we wrap up today, we want to revel in the grace of God. In the grace of God to live the Christian life, since we are no longer under the regime of the law, but we are under the grace of God, and what that means in our life to equip us and empower us to live Christ life in us, the resurrection life. So as we conclude today's service, we'll sing a couple songs. Let's start with Amazing Grace. today that God's grace is enough to handle any situation that comes our way this week. All right? Let's sing together.
Join me as we close our time, the benediction. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And may we all, with unveiled faces, behold the glory of the Lord, and may we be transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. And all God's people said, Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed.
Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough. Your grace is enough. Jesus.